Hi, everybody. So I'm Edward, and yesterday I was in Boston. In fact, this morning I was in Boston. But yesterday I was in Boston right about this time, and my cell phone rang, and I was working with a client, another arts education organization, and it was Dr. Michael Hanchett Hansen, who I know very well. And he calls me, and I pick up the phone, and his opening line when I answered the phone was, "This is probably an unlikely request, but," and here I am. So that's how I came to be here today. I'm very excited to be here today, and I feel that perhaps the stuff that I'll discuss with you will really connect to a lot of the thoughts and ideas that Dr. Hansen would have brought. Dr. Hansen is a great colleague and a mentor of mine. I first met him at Teachers College, where he heads up, he's the director of the Creativity and Cognition Program, and I was working with him on a bunch of projects there. And we have since kind of traveled here and there, presenting a certain approach to creativity that he and I are working on together. So I'll bring aspects of that into our discussion with my own little kind of flair. So, but Michael was really excited to work with you guys, and he's sorry he couldn't be here. What he said to me was that he was really hoping to have a lot of fun with this presentation. And based on the agenda that I've seen for the work that you're doing together this week, I can certainly see why. That would be fun. And I hope to have fun too. So I know that Michelle had sent out some information about who I am. I'll just really quickly go through that. My name is Edward. I'm originally from Long Island. And I studied undergrad up in New England, did some graduate studies in the UK, and then came back to New York City, where I worked here for about 6 or 8 years, playing a variety of roles in the arts sector as a teaching artist, an arts administrator, a researcher, a practicing artist myself. Working with organizations like the Bronx Council on the Arts, Young Audiences New York, and I was an adjunct professor at the CUNY, Borough Manhattan Community College down there, doing some work with them in creative writing. And then I kind of jumped up and said, I was looking at the field and looking at my work in the field, and I said, you know what, we can do this work better. And I thought a way to do that, because I sort of felt stifled in my position, a way to do that, I thought I needed to go back to school again and really dig into how the details and the research on the work that we do in arts teaching and learning environments. So currently I'm a doctoral student at the Harvard University Graduate School of Education, and I'm a teaching fellow there in the Arts and Education program, as well as a teaching fellow with another course, a psychology course on adult development, exploring the ways that adults grow and change and become more complex in their lives as they mature. So that's my background, and the thing about my research interests is they're really broad. I kind of speak and talk and write about a lot of things. Paramount among them are issues of leadership, issues pertaining to mentorship, especially developing new reciprocal models of mentorship rather than traditional top-down models of mentorship to really increase the capacity of individuals within institutions and broader fields from multiple directions. And I also look at I look at succession in arts education and the arts sector most broadly, where we're preparing for a changing of the guard, looking at the issues of generational change and leadership and what that means and how we can best prepare for or engage in that, because there's no more preparing, we're in it. So these seem really broad and diverse and perhaps not really connected to what you all do every day in classrooms with young people, but a through line through all of this stuff has been a focus on creativity and innovation. That's pretty much at the core of all this. I think of leadership through the lens of creativity. I think of mentorship through the lens of creativity, specifically what I'll talk about later, distributed creativity. And I think indeed about succession, about how can we be creative about reinventing ourselves anew as a field, as an industry, as a domain, as a society. So, for years, I've worked with colleagues like Dr. Hansen on wrestling with these ideas about creativity, about innovation, the same types of ideas you've been wrestling with all this week. So I hope to make big connections there. And what I've learned about studying creativity is that there really aren't any conclusions about creativity. There's nothing concrete, there's nothing absolute. Theorists don't agree what creativity even means, just as practitioners don't necessarily agree about what's the best way to foster or cultivate creativity. So although there is this lack of kind of the concrete, lack of definitive answers to creativity and understandings of what creativity is, I do feel like in my work, I have found something. And it might be a very small something, but I'm hoping that that something that I've found, which I'll be sharing with you, I think that will be useful to you. So I'm really excited to engage you in these ideas, engage you in this work. This is a different format from which I've usually presented these ideas. And I think I'm just really jazzed, really excited about it. It was a wild train ride down, like, okay, what am I gonna say? But everything somehow, PowerPoint, notes, everything worked out. So, and I thank Michelle and her colleagues for making that happen. So my goal for our hour together, and I'm not quite off book yet, our goal for our hour together is I would like to do a brief tour of the history of creativity studies, creativity research, give you, kind of situate you in the literature to let you know how creativity has changed, how we've thought about creativity differently over the past few decades and even the past few centuries. And then I'd like to pose a few traditional understandings of what creativity means and then problematize those things and say, wait a second, what if we think about this differently and how can we do this more effectively? So I'm going to pose a new understanding, a new approach to creativity, which some theorists are talking about, but I'd like to push it a little further and bring it into the sphere of education. And that is this notion of distributed creativity, the notion that creativity doesn't reside in the heads of any one or another individual. We're often taught that we have to kind of cultivate creativity in young people, singular, that one person. Michelle, we're gonna make you more creative. But Michelle's creativity isn't necessarily expressed all by herself. If Michelle were on an island all alone for many, many years, every action she did could be considered novel, but is that necessarily creative? But when we situate Michelle in society with other people, it's the interaction amongst groups that bring out creative ideas, that individuals participate in multiple ways. So it's how do we participate in creativity, not how do we become creative. That's what we'll be discussing today. But before we do that, before we jump into all this juicy stuff, I want to take an atypical approach to a keynote speech. Atypical in a way that I'm not just going to talk at you for an hour, I'm going to make you work a little bit. So what I'd like you to do, the first thing I'd like you to do, and I'm a little behind on my slides, is think for a minute. I'm gonna back up. Think for a minute, just kind of as you're coming into the room, as you come in today, what is your definition of creativity? If you were forced to define it, how would you do that? So take out a paper and pencil. You will not show this to anyone else. This is just for you. And think just the top of mind, the first thing comes to mind, how would you define creativity? Okay? So 1 minute and go. Just 1 minute. This is just for you. Okay, about 20 seconds. Okay, wrap up your final thought wherever you are. In 5, 4, 3, 2, pencils down. So let's move forward. Now, what we've done is kind of thought about creativity a little theoretically. However you defined it, you just said creativity is this, or creativity is that, or I see creativity as being X or Y or Z. But when we make definitions, they're sort of, you know, theoretical by nature. They're not really applied. They're not situated in an environment. And in the 1980s, creativity research took a big boost. There was this one theorist, his name was Howard Gruber. He worked at Teachers College. He was a protege of Jean Piaget. And Michael Hansen was a protege of Howard Gruber. And then here I am, that's the train. But Gruber said that the best way to understand creativity, to gain an understanding of creativity, was to study creative people at work. There were all these psychometric tests that have been developed where kids would take a creativity test or they'd be in a room and they'd have to figure out 700 uses for a brick or something like that. But that's not actually creativity in the wild. So the best way to look at creativity is to study it in process. So what does it look like in action? Don't tell me what it looks like in theory. Don't show me how I can fill in a box. What does it look like in process? What does it look like in action? So that's what I want you to think about right now. So this is your second task, okay? And that is, think of an experience that you've had, maybe in your professional life, in your personal life, where you've witnessed creativity. That's it. So think of an experience when you've witnessed creativity. So we're gonna have this thought writing experiment be a little longer than the last one, so a whole 2 minutes, okay? To really think about an experience where you saw creativity in action, okay? So just think about that. And some things you might wanna kind of add to that are, what about this experience was creative? Who were the characters involved in this scenario? What problem was either created or solved? What ideas were developed or explored? If this is helpful for you, you can use this as a reference, but we're thinking about creativity in action. You saw it happen. About another minute. Best you can, just come up with that scenario when you saw creativity in effect. About 30 seconds. Okay, about 10 seconds. Just kind of finish up your thought, complete that sentence, finish that sketch, you know, the work on the nose, and wrap it up. Okay, so here's where we're gonna go next with this. You've all got a concrete, or most of you, I hope, have a concrete sense. And if you don't have a concrete example, that's fine too. But we have an example of creativity in action. So what I'd like you to do is turn to the, you know, kind of make your small groups in this room, just sort of turn, I know we're not really set up for group work here, but maybe turn to the two or three people closest to you and share, exchange your experiences with creativity in action. So we'll spend about 5 or 7 minutes on this, and then I'll come back to you. Okay? Got it? You got it.
I'm sorry.
Two more minutes. One more minute. Okay, start to wrap it up. And come back. Come on back. Finish your thought and come on back. All right, great. Okay, let's finish our last thought and come back as a group. So thank you for sharing your experiences with your colleagues. I'm sorry I didn't get to jump in and hear each and every one. Look at all the case studies that just came out. As a researcher, I'm very excited. So what's it look like? What are some examples? What are some indicators of creativity? What were some things you saw or heard from your colleagues? Yeah.
Well, we talked about the fact that it's a process, not an event.
Okay. Can you give me a concrete example, maybe?
Well, we had an artist who came and spoke yesterday, and she was talking about sort of this gestation of ideas and responses and investigations over time.
Okay, great. So creativity is a process that occurs over time. Good. Other things that people, yes, please.
Well, I was saying, I think it's creativity is like a great conversation. It's a dialogue. When you talk to somebody and you don't exactly know where the conversation's going, but you're listening carefully and responding and reflecting and giving and taking, I think creativity is
okay.
That.
So you kind of jump in, you know the language, you know the rules, you kind of have that personal space and understand social cues, but you don't really know where it's going.
Yeah.
You just like engage and see where we wind up. Thank you. Yes, please.
I was thinking about it from a math point of view. I'm a math teacher.
Okay.
And I was thinking about creativity in the sense that there's a problem and no one has given you the tools and you come up with them.
So it's almost, some creativity research talks about the difference between creativity and emergency. So like it's almost like you're in emergency and boy, I gotta figure this one out fast.
Yeah.
But is that creative or is that survival? Distinctions. But yes, indeed. So when you don't have the tools, but you figure out a way to make it work against sort of those odds. How about in the back?
We had a couple of examples where people were dissatisfied with something, and so the dissatisfaction led to people being creative. So I don't know if that's survival too, but it was like if we were happy with it how it was, we wouldn't have been creative.
Mm-hmm. Yes, so this ongoing dissatisfaction with the status quo, with the way things are, that this that I know today can always be better. Even my own work that I know today can always be better. In an alternate life, I write about that a little bit, thinking of creativity as in terms of a type of sadness. You know, we think of creativity as this joy, but it's this unfulfillment, this malcontent with things as they always are. So if you can never reach satisfaction, what does that mean? Sir?
Yeah, I was thinking a lot. I think a lot about the emotional quality, and a lot. I think yesterday we heard a lot in Allison of fear and doubt, and there's this constant push and pull of can I make a leap of faith over that fear and doubt that is like part of the practice. And
great. So it involves this element of risk taking too. Then.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool. Thank you. Yes.
Another way to think of it is a quest toward a goal through the unknown, expecting perils.
Uh huh. Okay. Say a little bit more about unexpected perils. I could talk about my commute this morning.
Well, you know something's going to go wrong, but that you can handle it because the goal is worth it. But you
That's,
don't know when or where it's going to happen.
Yes, that
it
perfectly connects to my experience
morning.
This morning. Yes. Uh-huh. Yes, so, and that was sort of connected earlier. You're not really sure what's going to be going, where you're going, but you're bringing this element of the risk-taking piece, the fear, the sort of like, we know there's going to be pitfalls along the way. But the journey and the outcome is worth it.
You're prepared to fight the dragon.
Mm-hmm.
That's
okay.
Between you and the treasure.
Great. Yes.
But by the same token, working with small children, they don't know there's peril. They are risk takers by nature.
Mm-hmm.
So they're not as fearful as we can be. And it's hard. It's sometimes hard not to project your own fears of the outcome onto them.
But it's not like there isn't. I'm sorry to talk over you.
No, go ahead.
It's not like there's not peril or not fear. But perhaps the locus of fear is not on the actual students, but perhaps it's with the teacher. And how do you manage that fear and that peril? Or, you know, take those risks yourselves to say, I'm not really sure how the students are going to respond to this, where they're going to take it, but I'm willing to go in that place where I don't know where the conversation's going, but it's a conversation worth having. And these are the right people to have it. Okay, maybe, sir.
Well, how about trying to solve a creative problem by grouping people? Together, having a, whether it's an adult conversation or kids in the classroom, having them brainstorm and come up with an infectious creative solution.
Mm-hmm. So we need more resources here. This isn't something that any single one of us can figure out on our own. We need this kind of collaborative thinking. In the 90s, there was this notion of distributed cognition that came out, where the cognitive revolution that started in the 50s and 60s was all about the self, the individual. We wanted to know your IQ, and we could give you a test that said that. But then certain folks said, well, actually, cognition doesn't happen in the labs that you tested in, it happens in the wild. And how do we look at distributed cognition, how we make meaning of our experiences in collaboration with other actors and even other artifacts? Were you going to add something?
Just quickly, along the idea of the conversation,
mm-hmm.
creativity being a conversation allowing one to jump in, it allows for continued inspiration. Because inherent within each of us is that inkling, that desire
mm-hmm.
to be creative, to desire, see what does it look like. Even
mm-hmm.
though many of us are approached by people that say, how do you do that?
Mm-hmm.
How do you draw? How do you paint? And then it's that inherent discovery process
mm-hmm.
that impetus to make you want to.
Mm-hmm. I love that. Yes, that inspiration piece. It's almost in an odd way connected to the malcontent piece from earlier. It's this is not. I need to push this. My skills need to go further, or this can be more imaginative, or I can write a better poem, or come up with a better analysis of the data set. So yes, that kind of inspirational piece to go forward. Last one. Okay, good. I'm glad that one came up. Breaking and bending the rules. In the business literature, there's this notion of positive deviance. So the individuals within your organization, they already do things differently, but you shun them because they're different. But they don't do them differently. They're the positive deviants. They don't do them differently to be a pain in the butt. They do them differently because they just think about problems differently. And how do we look for those people who break rules? Not to be rule breakers, but break rules to be more efficient in ways that we can't even see the efficiency yet, or more innovative in ways that we can't even see the innovation yet. So how do we foster those people, those deviants, instead of push them to the sides because they make meaning in ways that we don't understand? So This is great. I really appreciate all the feedback and all the responses. I'm going to move forward because I'm conscious of our time. Believe it, we're halfway through. And go on that whirlwind tour of creativity with you. So we're going to start here. And this is just a random illuminated manuscript. I don't know what it says. But what I do know is that the root word of creativity is creare. It's a Latin word. And it means these things. Creare, to make, to produce, to birth, to beget. There's actually an Italian word, creo, that means these very same things. And from these words, we get the idea of creativity. Now, oddly enough, creativity, creare, creo, we didn't use these terms in the way, even though they seem like they apply to how we understand creativity today. Creative people are makers, they produce things, they birth new ideas, they beget new problems, they beget new solutions. It sounds like it makes sense. But it wasn't until about sometime in the 19th century, the early 19th century, that we started to apply the term creativity to individuals, to people, to mortals. Why do you think that might be? Yeah, there was only one person that was creative, okay? Only one person created anything, and you didn't mess with him. So it would actually be blasphemous in the 1700s, 1600s, or the 1200s to say that, you know, you can be creative, that I want to foster creativity, because only the big guy does the creative work, whatever creed you come from or don't come from. This was how in the West, creativity was thought of. It was something for a supernatural being that person did, not something that mortals did. But sometime in the 1800s, it actually started with literature, when they started to talk about literature as a form of creative writing. And then from there, creativity kind of caught on. But the first place we see it in academic literature is here. This is an article called, aptly named, Creativity. It's written by J.P. Guilford, and it was published in American Psychologist in 1950. It's the first place where creativity is prominently featured, called out to the psychology research community. And Guilford wrote this upon acceptance of his presidency to the American Psychological Association, known as APA. And he was calling for psychologists to really pay attention to this notion of creativity. In 1950, he predicted that creativity would be this really important avenue of psychological research. And the way that he talked about creativity was really interesting. He talked about creativity as a series of traits that people had. And he didn't say that there were creative people and there weren't creative people. He did not say that. He said we all have creative traits. It's just that creative people have more of them, or they're more pronounced in a certain way. So, because psychometrics and cognition, it was the middle of the cognitive, the dawn of the cognitive revolution, was so popular, Guilford wanted to know how psychology can develop psychometric systems that could measure, that could gauge creativity in the same way that we could gauge IQ, or that it's attempted to gauge IQ, which is known as G. When you get your IQ rating, that's your G, your general intelligence. So how can we develop a test that would you know, analyze an individual's general creativity? So this is the dawn of the first wave of creativity research, where psychologists were looking to develop psychometric systems to look for the personality traits within the individual that indicated who was not creative and who was not, but who was more creative and who was not. So this is the beginning of creativity. But what's also interesting, while he's calling out psychologists and saying this is an important area of study, get on it, he's also calling out us, educators. And in this quote, we can see this. It starts here. Why do we not produce a larger number of creative geniuses than we do under supposedly enlightened modern educational practices? Enlightened modern educational practices. Why isn't education producing more creative geniuses? And that's how creative individuals were spoken of. They were the geniuses, the Mozarts, the Bachs, the Einsteins, the Darwins. So this is the dawn of creativity research. And then we get into this whole cycle of looking at psychometric studies. And I, of course, and many of the fields of many individuals in psychology feel this is, and in education especially, feel like this is very problematic. Because if we look at ways to measure who is more or less creative, then we can really kind of start tracking people for creative jobs. It also suggests to us that we can't do anything through education or any other intervention to foster creativity. If you either have it or you don't, or you got more of it or less, then what can I do as an educator to make you more creative? So this whole focus on creativity within the individual, problematic. So that was the first wave of psychology, and things ebbed and flowed, grew and changed. This is when divergent thinking that I heard mentioned earlier, divergence and convergence, came into play, and how do we find individuals who have this capacity to do divergent thinking more than others who are more prone to convergent thinking. But then sometime in the 90s, we moved into sort of the second wave of creativity research, and it starts with these two guys. So this is Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi, pronounced Csikszentmihalyi, and this is Howard Gardner. And they both came up with this notion that they called the evolving systems approach to creativity. They weren't satisfied with the idea that individuals on their own, put on an island by themselves, could measure high in creativity or not just based on some personality traits that they had. So they said, we need to situate creativity in a broader environment, and we need to look at the system that creativity is engaged in. So they had this idea that there's three parts to creativity. We have the individual, the person, Michelle, who's out there doing her thing, and Michelle participates in what's known as the domain. Perhaps, let's say, the field of arts education is the domain. And this gets tricky because they use language in very specific ways. So the individual is engaged in the domain. A painter is involved in the domain of fine arts. And then there's the field. And the field isn't used as we commonly use that language. The field is a set of gatekeepers that determines what is accepted in the domain. So the creative individual makes a contribution to the domain that is judged by the field, and if the field deems this both novel and useful, then creativity happens. Mm-hmm. So these things are all in interaction with one another. The individual is interacting with the gatekeepers, with the domain is in constant interaction with the gatekeepers, and then if creativity occurs, it exists here. So what Csikszentmihalyi and Gardner did was, for the first time, they removed the locus of creativity from within the head of the individual and placed it in broader systems. So creativity happens when the individual makes a contribution to the domain approved by the gatekeepers and therefore changes the domain. Bing, creativity. But this was still not enough. And research on creativity continued. And then there's this guy. So we're stepping outside of creativity research for a little bit and going into the realm of psychology and sociology. And this is a sociologist, French sociologist. This is Bruno Latour. He's still alive and kicking and with us today. And Bruno Latour didn't like the notion of the way that the social sciences were going. We started to talk in the social sciences about about the social, how we are social, how we engage with one another in a social kind of way. And he wrote this book in 2005 called Reframing the Social, An Introduction to Actor Network Theory. And I'll explain what actor network theory is in a minute. But basically, and this is this long quote, I'll read it to you, that says, it is possible to remain faithful to the original institutions of the social sciences by redefining sociology not as the science of the social, but as the tracing of associations. In this meaning of the adjective, social does not designate a thing among other things, but a type of association between things that are not themselves social. So we can be in association with something that isn't social. So what he did was he opened up the sense that we can be engaged in a society that includes non-human entities. So as part of your network, you could be really engaged with a certain type of material, really engaged with a certain type of history, really engaged with a certain type of tool. So those things are not social, but you have associations with them that can buttress your understanding, your cognition. So he called this actor network theory, or ANT. And several times, I took it out. Nah, inside joke. Okay. So there's a hyphen that I left out, and you know there's theorists that argue where you put the hyphen. Yeah, it's important stuff. So actor network theory, the idea that multiple actors make up a social system, and not all actors are human, okay? So multiple actors make up a social system, the actors in a network. And those actors, as the network, as a system, act together, okay? Stay with me here. So then we get this guy. This is Keith Sawyer. He's a professor of, sociology, creativity, and a fair amount of other things, psychology, at Washington State University in St. Louis, Missouri. And he has this idea that he calls social emergence. And I heard it, I don't know who said it, but this whole notion that we can have ideas that emerge out of systems, and we can't trace the idea to any one contributor. The whole system came up with that idea. The idea emerged. So social emergence, he says, the idea that outcomes emerged out of systems in ways that cannot be reduced to individual contributions. Okay? And the way that one of the examples that he gives, and I think it's an okay example, is this. A V of geese. A V of, no one decides. There's no lead goose that says, all right, you over there, and let's go. It's sort of geese kind of take flight, and they near each other, and then they work off of one another's draft. And just by doing that, by setting that up, all of a sudden the V forms, and it's a more efficient way of flying. And then they trade off, it might even be happening now, they trade off who's the lead goose, because that person exerts the most strength. So the lead goose will then go back to the end and regain that individual strength and all this stuff. There's no one that's leading this. Geese do this all around the world, wherever there are geese. So Sawyer argues that this notion of the V, the goose V, is an example of social emergence. You can't trace that down to any one individual's contribution, any one individual's ideas. And while this is great and all, and I'm glad you went there with me, how does this affect creativity? What are we talking about here? And then how does it affect education? So where I'm going with this is back to the Gardner-Csikszentmihalyi model, where they have the individual up top. So I'm going to say this. What if we put the actor network up top, the system, the group, including the tools, the ideas, the history, the culture that's involved, the system? What if we put the system up there and said that individuals don't make contributions, systems do? And then we can use the model as it stands the same way. And we could call this distributed creativity. The idea that creativity is distributed across a complex actor network where innovative ideas emerge in a manner that no one innovation or another can be reduced to a single individual. Okay, so it's not the individual, it's the groups of individuals that contribute to make creativity happen. And then in this sense, neither the individual nor the actor network is creative. The idea is creative. So we don't have creativity of creative ideas. Okay. So thinking about that, this is how I describe distributed creativity, which is not my theory. Sawyer talks about that. Several other theorists write that up. The locus of creativity resides not within individuals. Individuals are not creative, but within the ideas groups of individuals work on together. Ideas are creative. They're not creative people or uncreative people. They're only creative ideas. And then there are multiple ways to engage with those creative ideas, multiple ways to participate in creative ideas. So creativity isn't a thing that I can foster in you. It's a process that we can all pursue, and we can participate in it in different levels. So what's the implications for this in life and work? I'll email these out so you can have those. So when we often talk, when we hear 21st century skills and young people need to be creative and all these other things, creativity is a big one in there, they're talking about individuals. But imagine, Csikszentmihalyi calls it the car crash of creativity. If everyone creatively interpreted the rules of the road, that would be interesting. So it's not that we can have 1,000 creative people all working for Google there have to be creative systems that operate in. That's how the world works. Creativity in the wild isn't a bunch of geniuses running around and bestowing their will, begotting. It's systems. It's groups of people. So when we teach young people to participate in distributed creativity, to understand what creative ideas are and how to pursue creative ideas, then we're better equipping them for the world of work, the world of school, and the world of life. So the implications I feel for educators are, is that as educators, you don't need to worry about cultivating creativity within individuals. If Johnny or Samantha or Michael is creative, isn't your concern. It's how the group of them are creative together. So instead, educators can create learning environments that require collaborative networks of young people to contribute to the development of creative ideas. So how can we develop environments where people with different skills, different abilities, are working together on comparable problems, coming up with novel and useful ideas? And lastly, this changes the question that a student might ask himself or herself, not how am I creative, but how can I participate in creativity? What's my role in pursuit of this joint effort that is a creative outcome? So what's it look like in action? This is like, he went the theory route, and I don't know what I'm going to do on Monday or something like that. To talk about this in action, I'm going to just really briefly talk about a case study, and then we're going to break for a little bit. Then we're going to break for questions. But when I got the call yesterday, I was working with the Boston Art Science Prize, which is an organization run by the Cloud Foundation in Boston. It's people I work for. I do professional development, curriculum design for them. And the Art Science Prize believes the future of the arts, the future of creativity, is a transformative approach to fusing different disciplines. So they focus on fusing the arts with the sciences. So in a classroom, they have a teaching artist who has an arts or design background, working with an innovator, a scientist, some type of entrepreneur. So they work together to kind of develop creative ideas. They start with an annual scientific theme. The first year their program ran, last year, it was neuroinformatics, the combination of neuroscience with information technology. Both of them are digital. Your brain either fires, your neurons fire or they don't, and computers are zero and ones, so how can we get them to talk to each other? And then this year, the annual scientific theme was the future of water. So students are given seed ideas that they start with, radical blue sky ideas that they begin with. How can you do this? And they're all within this scientific theme. And then they work in teams. So this is really a model of distributed creativity. They're working in teams. They're paired with these, what they call program mentors. They're constantly going on field trips, reaching out to experts in these fields. So knowledge and expertise is coming in. And eventually, and it's called Art Science Prize because it's actually a competition. They're competing for funding for their ideas. So they become not individuals. It's not Danny, Billy, and Hasma working on a project. It's NAVO, the nano voice that they're developing. So the group becomes the idea, and the idea continues to grow and evolve, and people participate in those ideas in multiple ways. So it's not, oh, I'm not creative, or oh, I'm not, there's a variety of ways for everyone to participate in a creative outcome by focusing, removing the locus of creativity from the individuals engaged in it, and doing that social emergence thing, saying what is the idea that can come of this that we can't trace to an individual? So, that's my show, but I have a closing thought, and I'm gonna read it to you, because, well, that's how I roll. So, for centuries, the definition of the word creativity has eluded us. In the past few decades, we have come to think of creativity as being a capacity that is in the heads of individuals. Some people would even suggest that creativity is a trait. You either have it or you don't. When we remove the locus of creativity from the individual and think of ways in which creativity can be distributed across a broad network of actors, we open up the opportunity to participate in creativity in a wide, we open up the opportunity to participate in creativity for a wide array of young people and adults with varying skill sets and diverse levels of expertise. teaching for creativity, from my perspective, is less about developing geniuses and more about developing opportunities for our students to deeply explore ideas together. Fostering environments where young people can participate in creativity requires only one unique pedagogical skill. And that, I think, is the will to engage the minds of young people and the heart to support them along the way. Whether you are a fifth grade arts teacher, a seventh grade math teacher, or high school guidance counselor, teaching for creativity in the manner that I suggest is something you're all equipped to do. Thank you.